All right, it's finally time for the big reveal. So it turns out that all the rest of the complexity can be described sort of building up from where we are right now. And so that's what we're going to spend the remainder of this module doing. So abstraction is, again, the idea of kind of ignoring the parts of the system that we don't care about anymore and being able to use an existing system or piece somewhere else and maybe in multiple places in order to do something more complicated. So what we're going to do on this slide is we're going to take that bit equality circuit that we built earlier, and you can go back and look in the video to see what's inside of that box, but now we're just going to treat it like a box. We have a box here that takes two inputs and produces an output if those two inputs are equal to each other. So that's what this box does. And again, you could go back and look at the things that are in that box to determine how they work, but now we just care about what we can do with them. So what we'll do here is we will take 64 copies of that bit equality circuit. So take everything that was inside of that box, duplicate it, you know, so that we have 64 copies, line them all up, and make all their A inputs labeled with a number corresponding to which circuit it is. Same thing with the B inputs. And make sure that all the B and A inputs correspond to each other. So this is the first bit of A, first bit of B. Second bit of A, second bit of B. And what we're going to get are 64 outputs. And each of those outputs is telling us whether the corresponding input bits were the same. And then if we put them all together into this giant AND gate, so suppose that we built this big AND gate that takes a whole bunch of inputs and only returns true if all of them are true, then we would have a circuit that returns true only if all of the A bits are equivalent to, are equal to their corresponding B bit. And that is the definition of bitwise equality at the word level. So now if we take all of this and we put it in a box, now we have two inputs that aren't just single bits, they're now an entire integer. So we have a 64-bit input A and a 64-bit input B, and here is a single bit output that tells us whether or not those two numbers were equal. And we've built that from scratch. It's a box, but inside of this box is all of this. And inside each of these boxes are the things that we saw before. So that's where we're gonna go from here on out, is building these larger and larger things using the smaller components. So we can build a word level two-way multiplexer, for instance. So remember that we had this multiplexer circuit and it had two inputs A and B and a selector bit S, and one value of S gave you A, another value of S gave you B. And so if you just take those two, if you take those values of S and you hook it up to 64 copies of that multiplexer circuit, and we've actually drawn the inside of the box this time because it's a little important how these things are hooked up. But basically this now builds us a 64-bit multiplexer. So now A and B coming into the multiplexer are 64 bits. S is still a single bit, so we draw it with a dotted line. And notice that these are darker now to indicate that they are now 64-bit lines coming in. And then the output here, notice that we're not combining it all into one gate at the end. So this is going to be a 64-bit output. So again, now we have a circuit where if we give it, you know, 0 as the selector bit, we're going to get all the bits of A coming out, none of the bits of B. And if we give S 1, we're going to get all the bits of B, none of the bits of A. So we're basically picking between A and B based on the value of S. It's worth thinking about how we might extend this to select between more than two inputs. So maybe take a minute and pause the video and think about how you would expand this to be able to handle two more inputs coming in. Well, so the way you would handle it is you'd need more selector bits, and so you'd have to start building up a slightly more complicated circuitry in there. But then you'd have a four-way multiplexer, because note that there are four possible combinations of these two inputs, right? So maybe 0, 0 corresponds to A, 0, 1 corresponds to B, 1, 0 corresponds to C, and 1, 1 corresponds to D. And so basically you can choose which of these four outputs you get based on the inputs. So it might be worth, again, pausing the video and thinking about how many selector inputs would be required for 8 data inputs. Well, in order to double the number of inputs here, we added one new selector line. And so it shouldn't surprise you terribly much that to double it again to 8 inputs, we simply need to add one more selector line. And that's that. It should hopefully be relatively intuitive why that is, right? Because if you think about these as bits in an integer ID for the input, the number of bits in the integer sort of, you know, adding another bit, you know, multiplies the number of values that we have. And specifically, we're doing this with bits, so the base is 2. So the number of things that we can identify with an n-bit selector is 2 to the n. So we can identify 2 things with 1-bit input, or 1-bit selector. We can identify 4 things with a 2-bit selector. We can identify 8 things with a 3-bit selector. And so if we had a 4-bit selector, we could identify up to 16 things, which incidentally is the number of registers that we have in Y86. And so we can have all the register inputs coming into this multiplexer, and we have as long as we have a 4-bit ID number coming in with these selector bits, we're gonna get the register value corresponding to that selector coming output. So hopefully you're starting to see how these things are gonna fit together. We talked about having a half adder. There's also a thing called a full adder. And here's what's inside the box. I'm not gonna look at it in too much detail right now. But basically, we kind of have some machinery that looks like the half adder, but it's a little more complicated. And the added complication is to deal with a carry in. So we have A and B, and now we have another bit that indicates whether we have a carry coming into this this digit. And once we have that, then we can chain these things together and we can build an adder that handles multi-bits. So, you know, we could chain together 64 of these and we'd have a 64-bit adder. As the cartoon on the front of this slide indicated, you can then do this for subtraction by further modifying it. And so now we've built a multiplexer. We've added a multiplexer in here, and we've wired things up slightly differently. And again, you know, you could build this in a tool that I'll mention here in a minute, and you can play with it, and you could build it up from scratch yourself and verify that it works. But this is actually a 2's complement adder subtractor, so it handles both addition and subtraction. You give it a bit to indicate whether you're doing addition or subtraction, and because of the property of doing 2's complement negation, B minus A is equivalent to doing B plus the complement of A plus 1. And so these little multiplexers up here handle the not A part. And then if this is set, then this is going to be the carry into the beginning. So again, the details of that not super important, but the point here is that we're starting to build up a fairly complicated circuit and a fairly capable circuit just by combining these low-level components in interesting ways. And hopefully you can anticipate that from here we're just going to keep on doing this. So we're going to combine adders and multiplexers to build up these ALUs, or these arithmetic logic units. So basically we're going to end up with an ALU that takes 2 inputs and performs either addition, subtraction, a binary AND, or a binary XOR, just depending on what operation you use to select. And hopefully at this point you've identified that these are the 4 operations that are supported in Y86. Once we have all these other components, some of which we haven't built up yet, we're going to put them all together to build our CPU. And once we have our CPU, we're going to combine it with all of the other components in a computer and we're going to finally have, you know, the thing that we think of as being a computer, now that we've combined all these components together. Okay, so that's the big picture. So basic systems design is exploiting abstraction to build these complicated things out of smaller things. And the key here is that we're able to sort of ignore the details for the smaller things, because we can look at them as sort of this opaque box where we have ignored the details of what's going on inside. And this is true of most areas and systems. You know, we've seen this in 261 with the stuff that we've done today. We've also seen how we've been able to use C as sort of an abstraction over assembly, which is itself kind of an abstraction over machine code. And then Java and Python are an abstraction. You know, a lot of the Java and Python subsystems are written in C in many cases. And this is also going to be true in all the other systems courses that you take. And the details aren't important here, but what I want to emphasize is that this concept of abstraction in systems design is a really important concept, and it's one that's used all over computer science, and especially in systems. Okay, so we've hit the bottom, right? We hit digital logic circuits. That's the bottom. That's as far as we're going to go. As we started to do today, now we're going to start going back up. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to study sequential circuits, which is going to get us the concept of memory in our computer. And then we're going to look at how we start to put all these pieces together to build a full-fledged CPU. At this point, I would suggest that you start playing around with a tool called Logisim. So this is a tool that can be used to simulate building circuits on your computer and playing around with them. And I find it very useful in understanding how these circuits work to actually be able to build them and play with them. And I hope that you'll spend some time playing with them as well. I'll provide a file on Canvas that you can download as sort of a starter with some of these circuits to play around with. But I also hope that you spend some time building your own and experimenting with it.